And for some of you who were prayed for this morning, you are wordsmiths. You're like me. I mean, I can't draw, I can't paint, but I create things with words, images with words. It's what God has gifted me. I'm creative with words. And some of you this morning, that's your gift. But for most of you who I prayed for and anointed with oil this morning, that is not your gift. It could be dance, it could be music, it could be writing poetry, it could be painting, it could be craft, it could be video, it could be using computer technology, all sorts of things. But you, in all of those things, listen carefully, need to be open to God using you to bring His word in all sorts of unexpected places. Places maybe that you go every single day, every single week, may have gone for years. But there may be a day coming soon when God wants to use you. Maybe through a piece of art that's sitting on your desk at work, or maybe something that you have in your car. Maybe it's some social context that you go into. God may want to do something remarkable, extraordinary through you. But you need to have your eyes open, spiritual eyes open, spiritual ears open. And then you need to do, and I prayed specifically for a few people with this morning, but it's true of all of us, you need the courage to do it. The courage to do it. To paint it, to say it, to give it, to show it, to do it. To allow God to work through you in that context or situation.
The Christmas Story, Part 4, Listening to God by Pastor David Wise, is inspired by Luke chapter 2, verses 21 to 40. In this teaching, Pastor David encourages us all to listen to God so that we may be guided by His Holy Spirit. He shows us that old age need not be a barrier to serving God, and that there is no sitting on the fence when it comes to having a relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ.
Father God, thank you for all you have done among us already this morning. It's been an extraordinary morning of your presence and your activity. Father God, thank you. Now, as we turn to your written word, we want to ask for that extraordinary activity to continue. As we look this morning at the way that the intervention of your Spirit turned the mundane into the most extraordinary, Father, help us to see that that is the way that sometimes you want to work through our lives. Mundane things turned into extraordinary things because you enable and empower through your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're continuing with this seasonal series, part 4 today. Part 5, the final part, will be next week, and Assistant Pastor Warren will be doing that next week. Now, 2 weeks ago, we looked at Luke chapter 2, verse 1 to 20. We looked at Jesus' birth. Who was here for that? I'm sure there were more than 6 people here. Yeah, you know what's coming next, don't you? That's why you're so reluctant to put your hands up. You shy lot. What were the key things? Here's the question. What are the key things we learned, not last week, but 2 weeks ago when we looked at Luke chapter 2 and we looked at the birth of Jesus? We talked a bit about angels and shepherds and stuff around that. What can you remember what some of the key things that we learned 2 weeks ago were? Because it stands at the basis of what we're doing today. I see that hand right at the back. Why is it that people... anyway, there we go. Chris.
That God turned everything on its head. You know, this was a king coming to our world, and yet he was born in a very lowly place, in a very mucky, dirty stable. And it was shepherds who were sort of rather looked upon as the scum that got the message first.
Yeah. Yeah, the values of the kingdom upside down to our human values. Very good. What else did we see last time? What other key things did we see? Good, and you're sitting near the front as well, so that's even better.
Don't argue with angels.
Yeah, don't go arguing with angels. Very, very good. Very good. Do you remember we saw last time about how the census was organised by someone who actually was full of their own importance and believed that they were actually God? And yet here were they, unwittingly, unknowingly, fulfilling God's word from hundreds of years before. That God can work through people even when they are not aware of it. We looked about how God cares about those, as Chris has said, society doesn't value. We looked also at the Saviour coming, bringing peace. We looked at the fact that Jesus is here, and we also looked at people's responses. Do you remember there were three responses that we looked at the end last time? And the point of that was that being amazed is not enough. Being amazed at what God is doing, at what God is saying, is not enough. We need to be people who do God's word. Well, this morning we're jumping forward a month. So last time we looked at Jesus' birth, the shepherds. We're now going about a month forward from that. And we're going to see, as I indicated in the prayer at the beginning, how the ordinary and mundane were suddenly transformed by the intervention of people who were listening to God. Now, I want you to listen with perhaps a slightly different set of ears this morning. You know, you could read this story and think, well, that's all very interesting. Next time Jesus is born and I'm knocking around the temple, I might listen to God to see if he's got something to say. Yeah, I mean, you could look at it as that sort of old story and these amazing people and, yeah, wasn't that fantastic? What I want you to listen to instead, you can listen to that, that's fine, but what I want you to do instead is, what is God saying about you and what you do and where you go and maybe where you've been going for many, many years that God might want to use you one day in a completely unexpected way to bring amazing change and transformation into people's lives. I had someone in my office a couple of weeks ago, not someone you know, asked to come and see me. And they'd been given this word by God and they weren't altogether sure what it meant. And I was saying to them, you know, do you realise that actually you are the place where heaven touches earth? It's true for all of us. We are the place where heaven touches earth. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. And so part of what that means for you, it's about you bringing God's word to people as you meet them, as they come to you, as they're in your location, in your context, bringing God's word to those people, just allowing that to come through you. And you're all capable of that to a far greater degree than you can possibly imagine. Many years ago, I was a young people's leader. Can you imagine that, me being a young people's leader? Yeah, it's about 40-ish years ago, I was a young people's leader in a church. And had these two new converts, and they were just wild for God. I mean, we're talking 40 years ago. They would do forward rolls down the aisles praising God. You know, just not the sort of thing that you would normally do. And they told me the story. They said, oh, David, because I wasn't pastor this, it was David, last Tuesday, God told us to get on a bus and go to a bus station in Aldershot. I think it was Aldershot, could have been Farnham. I don't remember where it was now. And so we just got on the bus and went. These people have been a Christian about a week. So we got off the bus and said, well, what do we do now? And they said, that man over there, this is what I want to say to him. Go and pray for him. These are two 15, 16-year-old lads. So they just got on and did it. They said it was amazing. He started crying. And God really spoke to him. And it was just amazing that God used us like that. And that's, you might think that's extraordinary, but actually, that's normal. I don't mean getting on buses, but actually I mean God speaking through us to people, wanting to use you. So have that open in your mind as we look at this story this morning. Luke chapter 2, verse 21 is where we begin. Luke 2, 21, and we're going down this morning to verse 40. And the title this morning is Listening to God. Listening to God. On the eighth day, when it was time to circumcise him, he was named Jesus, the name the angel had given him before he had been conceived. When the time of their purification, according to the law of Moses, had been completed, Joseph and Mary took him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male is to be consecrated to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice in keeping with what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of doves or two young pigeons. If you'd like to, can you turn back to Leviticus chapter 12? Old Testament, near the front, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers. If you found Numbers, you've gone too far. Leviticus chapter 12. And the first eight verses. The Lord said to Moses, say to the Israelites, a woman who becomes pregnant and gives birth to a son will be ceremonially unclean for 7 days, just as she is unclean during her monthly period. On the eighth day, the boy is to be circumcised. Then the woman must wait 33 days to be purified from her bleeding. She must not touch anything sacred or go to the sanctuary until the days of her purification are over. If she gives birth to a daughter for 2 weeks, the woman will be unclean, as during her period she must wait 66 days to be purified from her bleeding. When the days of her purification for a son or a daughter are over, she is to bring to the priest at the entrance to the tent of meeting. They didn't have a temple in those days, it was the tabernacle, the tent. A year-old lamb for a burnt offering, and a young pigeon or a dove for a sin offering. He shall offer them before the Lord to make atonement for her, and then she will be ceremonially clean from her flow of blood. These are the regulations for the woman who gives birth to a boy or to a girl. If she cannot afford a lamb, she is to bring two doves or two young pigeons, one for a burnt offering and the other for a sin offering. In this way, the priest will make atonement for her, and she will be clean. So here we have Mary and Joseph, as recorded in Luke chapter 2, obediently following what God required of them, these sacrifices for purification. Notice that they only made the offering of a poor person. It just underlines what we were looking at 2 weeks ago, that actually Jesus was born into poverty. And not long after this, of course, he became a refugee, having to flee his own country, even though it was an occupied territory, having to flee that because his life was in danger and go to a foreign country. That's the beginning of the life of Jesus. In poverty, soon already homeless, soon to become a refugee in another nation. Normally on the 40th day, a firstborn son was redeemed by the payment of 5 shekels to a priest. This went back to the Passover, when during the night the firstborn sons of all the Egyptians were killed by God. And in God's sight, of course, all the Israelites also deserved to die. But God was willing to accept from the Levites the fact that they gave themselves to lifelong service to God in the tabernacle, later becoming the temple. And from the members of all the other tribes, this symbolic payment of 5 shekels. However, this didn't usually take place in the temple. And it's interesting, there is no reference to the redemption payment being made, because, of course, Jesus was without sin. We're going to explore more of this next week. But what there is going on here, and further on in the passage, echoes from a very significant story in the Old Testament. And I'd like you to turn also, so it's hunting time, for the book of Samuel in the Old Testament. If you don't know where it is, recommend the index. Ever so handy, finding your way where it is. And we're going to 1 Samuel, and we're going to 1 Samuel chapter 1. And Luke, in his writing of this account of Jesus here, both in these verses and later in this passage, he's drawing on this example from the Old Testament, this famous example from the book of Samuel, first book of Samuel, chapter 1. And I'm not going to read the whole of the story, but the background to this is there is a lady called Hannah, married to Elkanah, and she desperately, desperately wants a son. And she goes to the temple and weeps and prays. And in bitterness of soul, verse 10, Hannah wept much and prayed to the Lord. Verse 11, and she made a vow, saying, O Lord Almighty, if you will only look upon your servant's misery and remember me, and forget not your servant, but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head. Let's drop down to verse 21. So she has a son. God hears her prayer. When the man Elkanah went up with his family to offer the annual sacrifice to the Lord and so fulfill his vow, Hannah did not go. She said to her husband, after the boy is weaned, I will take him and present him before the Lord, and he will live there, being at the temple, always. Do what seems best to you, Elkanah, her husband told her. Stay here until you've weaned him. Only may the Lord make good his word. So the woman stayed at home and nursed her son until she'd weaned him. And after he was weaned, she took the boy with her, young as he was, along with a 3-year-old bull, an ephah of flour, a skin of wine, and brought them to the house of the Lord at Shiloh. When they'd slaughtered the bull, they brought the boy to Eli, who was the chief priest. She said to him, as surely as you live, my Lord, I am the woman who stood here beside you praying to the Lord. I prayed for this child, and the Lord granted me what I asked of him. So now I give him to the Lord. For his whole life he shall be given over to the Lord. And he worshipped the Lord there. And so Samuel is left in the temple, and you will know the story, which we're not looking at today, how later on God speaks to him and calls him. And that's the background of the passages that we're going to read this morning. It's there in the background as a model that Luke is pulling on. So here we have Jesus not being redeemed, but being consecrated to the Lord. And then this happened. Verse 25. So far, what you'd expect, almost. Then this. Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon. He was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Christ. Now, Simeon wasn't a priest. He was just an ordinary member of the public who'd given his whole life over to serving God. And here's the very strange thing. On him, the Holy Spirit rested. Now you think, well, so what? Well, actually, this is before Pentecost. God's Holy Spirit resting on someone was very, very rare. But that's his experience. And he's waiting for the consolation of Israel. And you think, what on earth is that? Well, what that is this. At that time, Israel was occupied, been invaded by the Romans, was occupied by the Romans, and they'd put in power governing the land, the territory of Israel, a particularly nasty king who was very, very cruel. And the consolation was a word which the Jews used referring to the expectation that God was going to come and was going to intervene in history, was going to get rid of those nasty Romans and that evil king, and was going to bring the Messiah, the Christ, to come, who would actually make the people of Israel the top nation, they believed, and they would be running things and the Romans would be gone. That was what they were looking for. The consolation of Israel was the technical phrase they used for that. Now, I want you to imagine that you are Simeon. And I want you to imagine that there you are. You've heard God say these things to you that you've read about. I've just read to you. And every day you're going to the temple. And all we know about Simeon is what I've read to you. So we're now going to imagine. Now, I appreciate this is slightly speculative, but actually, that's fine. That's why God's given us imaginations. I want you to imagine what Simeon's life was like. I want you to imagine what he might be feeling and thinking as he went to the temple each day, having heard God say these things. I don't know how long he'd been going to the temple. Could have been 10 years. Might have been 20 years. Might have been 30 years. But the way it reads is that it was a pretty long period of time. He'd been tipping up at the temple every day, waiting to see the consolation of Israel. Now, you know, he could be quite old by this point. I think that's likely, actually. We don't know that, but I think it's likely. So I want you to imagine that you're Simeon. What? And you've just turned up at the temple for the upteenth time. And I want you to just think for a moment how you might be thinking, how you might be feeling, what might be going through your mind, the thoughts and the fears, maybe, doubts, maybe, excitement, maybe. What would be running, do you think, through Simeon's mind? What do you think? And by the way, I'm going to come to you, Linda. Simeon was a bloke, just thought I'd mention that. I know that men find it a bit hard to use their imagination sometimes, but you know, you've got a bloke to work on here, so see if you can have a go, guys, okay? Don't just leave it to the ladies. Is that okay? Is that all right? I didn't hear many blokes speaking there. I saw lots of ladies nodding. Yeah. Is that okay, guys? Fantastic. I know you're not a guy, Linda, but we'll start with you.
Thank you. Maybe he thought somebody resplendent, you know, fantastic, big, grown up, would be the king, would be their redeemer. He might not have expected a little baby.
Okay, so that's very interesting. Maybe he's looking for someone with some swagger wandering into the temple. A bit of swagger coming in to the temple, looking like that he's going to get rid of those Romans. Maybe with a couple of dozen people trotting behind him with some big knives. So maybe that's what he's looking for. Very interesting. Yeah. John, I know you're a bloke, so you'll do.
Yeah, the thought that came to me was that Jesus met somebody else later on who said to him, I can't even remember what the context was, but said to him, I believe, help my unbelief. And I think if I was Simeon, I might be in that position a bit now, because if I've been praying this for a long period of time, and if God has said something specific to me, because I'm righteous and devout, I would think, yeah, okay, I accept that, but I haven't seen it. And the longer you're saying, okay, I accept that and I believe that, but I haven't seen it, and the older you get, you're thinking, am I actually going to see this before I die or not? And so he's on the edge of this sort of excitement, but is this going to miss me out?
Mm-hmm. Very interesting.
I think he might have been wanting to help God out with this thing. I mean, it's taken so long. There should be something I can do.
Yeah, there's quite a history of that in the Old Testament, isn't there, of people thinking they can give God a hand, and it often didn't turn out terribly well. But, yeah? Anything else?
I think there might also have been a bit of intrigue. Where will this person come from? Which part of Israel will he come from? Which household? Which family? What will he look like? What will he look like? Tall? Short? Big, fat, whatever. So, intrigue.
Mm-hmm. Sorry.
I was going to say, Simeon was constantly there. But when it happened, I mean, a lot of blokes, we go to church and we're constant. But when it happened, it was just a revelation that just happened. It was just an amazing revelation to Simeon. At that point, it was just so I think, as you talk about blokes, we need to expect the unexpected. And when we come to church, or we came this morning, we saw a revelation of God's Holy Spirit moving. We need to take control of that. I had to be prompted to come out to the front. And so, but Simeon wasn't prompted. He went there. He was constantly went to the temple, but it was revealed in a great way to him.
Very good. Very good. Now, sometimes we go through life, even come to church, with these blinkers on. You know, like, you know, the horses, they have these blinkers. They can only see just what's in front of them. And they can't see what's going on around them. And blokes are very good at doing that. And when God is doing something around them, they don't see it, because they're too busy looking at what's right in front of their nose. And which is perhaps why someone else saw this morning that God wanted to do something in your life and you hadn't seen it, and they gave you a shove. Was it a woman that gave you a shove? It was another bloke, was it? Okay, well, that's at least another bloke not wearing blinkers. That's encouraging. Okay, let's see what happened. What happened next in verse 27. Moved by the Spirit. Just notice that. Moved by the Spirit. He went into the temple courts. When the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the law required, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all the people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. Now, Simeon was guided to be by the Spirit to be in the right place at the right time and to be able to see and proclaim. No one else standing around seeing this couple wandering in with a baby, doing the stuff that couples with babies wander in and do every single day. No one else saw it at that point. See, Simeon's eyes, spiritual eyes, were open. If his eyes had been closed, he would have missed it. If he'd taken a day off from doing what God wanted him to do, wouldn't have been another chance. And I don't think he was, you know, I'm with Linda here. I'm not sure he was looking for a baby. You know, this, what he says here, is a huge thing, humongous great thing. My eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. Jesus was perhaps 40 days old at this point, roughly. Forty-day-year-old babies don't often look like God's salvation that he's prepared in the sight of all people, a light of revelation for the Gentiles. But his eyes were open to see what God was up to. How many babies do you think he'd seen before? How many hundreds, hundreds and hundreds of babies? Because everyone had to do this with their 40-day-old baby. How many hundreds and hundreds of babies had gone past him before? Couples shuffling past, doing what they needed to do. And yet he saw, because he was listening to God, because his eyes, his spiritual eyes, were open. What an extraordinary thing. We read it and we think, you know, I don't know whether in your mind you think that somehow Jesus had one of these, you know, golden halo things around his head, and you know, the, you know, the little, this little stick coming up the back with the parents, and a little gold thing around their head, that somehow it was very, very obvious. Maybe some great big pointer down from the sky, or there were angels singing in the background, or there was this wonderful smell of incense as they, you know. No, none of that. None of that. None of it at all. Couple, baby, might well have been a bit smelly. 40-day-year-old babies are often a bit smelly, aren't they? I'm a granddad, so, you know. Observing that, mine are a bit older than that now, but... And yet he saw, amazingly, what God was doing, because his eyes were open. His eyes were open to see. His words here are all full of echoes from the prophet Isaiah. Again, you know, just stressing the plan, the point that this is part of God's long-term plan. These words he was using were 600-ish years old. And even more amazingly, and this is staggering. This is absolutely staggering. He saw that the salvation wasn't just for the Jews. That's all the Jews were expecting, was big military warrior to come in and to lead them in revolt against the Romans, to get rid of the Romans and set up the Jews as the leading power. That's all they were expecting. That's not what he saw. It's a light for who? The Gentiles, the non-Jews, us lot, well, most of us lot. There's at least one, and maybe more than one, that I don't know about, Jews in the congregation, people of Jewish heritage and background. So it's seen there. And what an extraordinary thing to see. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel. What he saw was a light for the whole of the world, for all people. And for a devout Jew to see that is absolutely extraordinary. The child's father and mother, verse 33, marveled at what was said about him. You bet they did. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, "This child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." This falling and rising of many is an image that some of you may not be familiar with. It's an Old Testament image. And it's an image that comes from a large stone, a huge stone, a big rock, that's in the middle of a pathway. And as people come to this large rock, this large stone in the pathway, one of two things happens. They either rise because they are lifted up as they walk over the stone, the lifting up of many, or they stumble and fall, the falling of many. So it's the rising or falling. There is no alternative. You either can't go through the thing. It's either a rising or a falling. So the point is that people are either exalted or humbled, depending on their response to God's salvation. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 6 to 8. You can turn to it if you like to, or you can just listen. For in Scripture it says, "See, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone." Cornerstones were big, big stones. "And the one who trusts in him will never be put to shame. Now to you who believe, this stone is precious. But to those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the capstone, and a stone that causes men to stumble and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the message, which is also what they were destined for." Now, do you notice here that there are actually only two options? Anybody else notice that? Two options. Yeah? You with me? Two options. Being lifted up or stumbling. Being exalted or humbled. Two options. And against what a lot of people like to think and believe, in fact, in response to the gospel of Jesus, there are only two responses possible. There is no third response. There is no fuzzy grey area. I know we like to, in our culture these days, we like fuzzy grey stuff. You know, it's neither this or that. It's sort of, you know, balanced and in the middle in some way. God's not a God of balance, by the way, just for at least my reading of the Bible. He's quite extreme in his blessings and all of that. He's, you know, he doesn't do balance, really. But there's one of two responses. Either of accepting Jesus and being lifted up, which is about into God's presence, or rejecting Jesus and falling and eventually coming under God's judgment. Those are the only two options. There actually isn't a fence to sit on. I know some people say, "Oh, I'm sitting on the fence. I haven't made a decision yet." Well, you have made a decision. Until you make the decision yes, you've made the decision no. There is no fence. Sorry about that. If you think you're sitting on it, you're not, because there ain't one. It's one or the other. So if you have not yet made that decision to actually give your life over to God, to serve God, to welcome Jesus, and I would add to see that through in baptism as well, you're not sitting on the fence, you are currently outside the kingdom. But the invitation is there for you to come inside, for you to be welcomed into the kingdom. We sang about that a lot this morning, that what God wants to do, that's his heart for you. That's what he wants for you. I don't know who they are, because I didn't speak to them directly, but I know there are at least two people who came forward this morning, asked about commitment to God and baptism this morning. I mean, there was no appeal for that, at least I didn't notice one, but just in all the rest of the amazing things God was doing this morning, just that happened as well. Because God was at work. And I think for those people, I would guess they're realizing, well, actually, I'm either in with God here or I'm not. And actually, right now, I really want to be in. Two choices. And Simeon also anticipated how some would respond to Jesus, would cause great pain to Mary. I'm sure Mary, as she watched Jesus grow, had great hopes, huge hopes, expectations for him. Particularly after, you know, a few years later when these wise men from the east turn up. Jesus was not a baby by then. When you read it in Matthew's gospel, he was a child, so perhaps around 3 years old or thereabouts. Huge expectations for his son, for her son. And when she stood there and watched the crucifixion, a sword, said Simeon, will pierce your soul. He saw that right at the beginning. Verse 36. There was also a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was very old. She had lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, and then she was a widow until she was 84. I'll come back to that in a moment. She never left the temple, but worshipped night and day, fasting and praying. Coming up to them at that very moment, she gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were looking forward to the redemption of Jerusalem. Luke's description of Anna's age is ambiguous, as you'll see if you've got an NIV in the footnotes. She might have been 84, which is those days was seriously old. But she equally might have been 105. Married at 14 years, married for 7 years, and a widow for 84. If you add those up, it's 105. And it may be because Luke says she was very old, that actually I'm more inclined to be with the 105 than the 84. 84 was old, but 105 in those days was very old. But you can go for either. But here she is, devoted to God, listening to God. So here's a question for you. And for you particularly ladies, but guys, God's given you imaginations, emotions and feelings. You can use some of those as well. What do you think Anna's life was like? Her thinking, her feeling. You can choose 84 or 105, whatever you like. But she's been a widow for at least 84 years, either way. Well, been a widow for 60 years. She's been a widow a long time, either way. widows didn't have a terribly high social standing in Israel at that time. What do you think? What do you think she might have been thinking and feeling as she tipped up at the temple? Never left the temple, but worshipped night and day, fasting and praying. For at least 60 years, maybe 84. Any thoughts? What had she been thinking, feeling? I recognise that expression on your face, Joan. I know you want to say something.
It's a thinking.
I know it's a thinking expression, but when I see that expression on your face, I know that thinking expression actually normally comes before you saying something really interesting.
Oh, dear. I wonder whether she had had any conversation with Simeon, whether they had discussed things together. She was a prophetess. God had said things to her too, which are not recorded here, but they were things of hope. And she got no deadline, and she was getting older all the time. And, yeah, God was keeping her there until something happened. And I think she would have still had a sense of expectation. That's all.
That was worth coming over and receiving from you. I think it's likely that they may, because they would have seen, you know, they were in the temple all the time, and there weren't a lot of people who were there all the time. And she'd been there at least 60 years. So I think they may well have had some conversation. Interesting thought. Anything else you think, maybe?
I thought maybe having been widowed for such a young age and husband died, and she decided that there was the love of God was better than life, and dedicated her life to serving God in the temple.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, let's move on to these last few verses. Oh, by the way, I should have said that the redemption of Israel, sorry, the redemption of Jerusalem is just another phrase like the consolation of Israel. These were equivalent phrases. And once again, she's in the right place at the right time, listening to God. When Mary and Joseph had done everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong. He was filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. And again, in these words, there are deliberate echoes of Samuel's childhood. And the important fact that Jesus grew up with God-fearing parents. Now, part of the amazing mystery of the incarnation, which Warren's going to explore with us next week, is Jesus growing up as a normal child. He was 30 years old before he began his ministry. I wonder what that means for us. We're going to explore some of that and the theology behind that, and understanding and significance for us of that with Warren next week. Now, our time is nearly gone. I want to draw together some of the key things that we've learned from here. And make a link back to early this morning as well. The first thing I've got here in my notes, and this was written before this morning. What have we learned today? The importance of allowing ourselves to be guided by the Holy Spirit. Those of you who were, it applies to all of you, but particularly those of you who were prayed for this morning. And for those that are looking at this on the internet, we prayed and anointed with oil this morning. I'm not quite sure how many, but it was certainly over 30, might have been 40 people this morning who made a response to God about using their creative gifts for him. And I've already made the link here between the creative and the prophetic. The prophetic is about bringing the now word of God into someone's life, into a context at this point in time. Now, for those of you, you know, when we often talk about prophecy, we just think about words. And for some of you who were prayed for this morning, you are wordsmiths. You're like me. I mean, I can't draw, I can't paint, but I create things with words, images with words. It's what God has gifted me. I'm creative with words. And some of you this morning, that's your gift. But for most of you who I prayed for and anointed with oil this morning, that is not your gift. It could be dance, it could be music, it could be writing poetry, it could be painting, it could be craft, it could be video, it could be using computer technology, all sorts of things. But you, in all of those things, listen carefully, need to be open to God using you to bring his word in all sorts of unexpected places. Places maybe that you go every single day, every single week, may have gone for years. But there may be a day coming soon when God wants to use you. Maybe through a piece of art that's sitting on your desk at work, or maybe something that you have in your car. Maybe it's some social context that you go into. God may want to do something remarkable, extraordinary through you. But you need to have your eyes open, spiritual eyes open, spiritual ears open. And then you need to do, and I prayed specifically for a few people with this morning, but it's true of all of us, you need the courage to do it. The courage to do it. To paint it, to say it, to give it, to show it. To do it, to allow God to work through you in that context or situation. These were ordinary people in an ordinary place who God used in extraordinary ways. And that's what God wants for all of us. The supernatural life is normal. For all of you, in Jesus. Second thing to say, you are never too old to serve God. Anybody here older than 105? There are a few perhaps who are older than 84. You don't need to put your hand up to own that. You're never too old for God to use you. And finally, there are only ever two options in our response to Jesus. Let's stand together, give you a moment just to listen to God. There may be something God wants to put in your heart and mind, and then I'm going to pray for you. We've gone slightly over time this morning. I'm almost sorry about that, but let's pray together. Father God, thank you for Simeon and Anna. These two very ordinary people who devoted their lives to serving you, and at that moment they were willing to go right out on a limb and to say what you gave them to say, to do what you gave them to do. Father God, I want to pray for us, all of us here in this congregation this morning, for those who are watching this subsequently, for every one of you. The fact is that you have, if you're a Christian, you have God's Holy Spirit inside of you, already there. And God wants to use you, perhaps in places that you've never been used for, before in ways that are completely unexpected. God wants to use you. And I want to pray for open eyes, open ears, and courage to do what God asks. That we see extraordinary things happen in what otherwise are ordinary situations and circumstances. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.